have people on the panel representing very different factors and approaches to local and community media. They're each going to talk for about 10 minutes, and then we're going to have a bit of a round table type discussion. And if possible, I'd like to engage as many people in the auditorium as possible. So actually think through what questions and contributions and try and generate some kind of a conversation in the second half rather than it being kind of a them and us situation. So let me briefly introduce the people who will be speaking to you today. We're going to start with Adam Cantwell-Corn from Bristol Cable. Bristol Cable is a very different type of model. It runs on a cooperative basis. It has shared editorships and also offers free workshops for contributors. And it has a mission to give a voice to the marginalised. So it's operating from a very particular ethos and approach. Then we'll move on to Ian Carter from the KM Media Group, who, and I've forgotten already, he's now just told me, has 26, did you say? 26 printed local titles under its ambit. So he's not one of those big local media groups, one of the big five, as I say, but he's still a fairly sizable commercial media group offering up local media of a different type. Then we have Peter Lewis, who's an expert in community radio, and he's going to talk to us from his experience around that. Peter is from London Met, and Andy Williams from Cardiff, who has done lots of work with hyperlocals and is going to talk from that perspective.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Adam. I'm a co-founder of Bristol Cable. We are a media cooperative. We've been going just over a year as an established organisation. And to kind of like just follow up on what Natalie said about our mission statement is Bristol Cable is redefining local journalism through challenging multimedia, community action, cooperative ownership, online, in print, and on the street. Now, the topic of this talk is local and community media. I'm going to kind of cut that in half straight away and talk a little bit about, specifically about community media. Because they are very different things, and often they are kind of like thrown in together, but that's potentially an unnatural or unnecessary joining of the two, with one being solely geographically defined, and the other being defined through a more tighter value proposition beyond the bare fact of a potential consumer or reader being in the locality. So, talking about community media, I'm going to draw on the experiences of the Bristol Cable and put forward a couple of ideas of how community media can be brought up to a kind of a respectable basis and one that has like a real standing within the media sector as a whole. So my view is that established local media, with exceptions, has not been adequately making a convincing value proposition, and as a result is losing the traditional loyalties that kept it afloat in the past. That's being compounded by other developments such as the internet, lots of different free media outlets, social media and so on, so people aren't relying on these kind of traditional news sources for their information on the day-to-day basis. As a result, there's been, as we all know, a retreat in traditional local media availability and crucially in quality, with wide-ranging closures and cutbacks in a cyclical fashion that reinforces one itself. But this retreat presents an opportunity that at the Bristol Cable we're trying to exploit. That opportunity is to redefine a model for local media on a community basis, an opportunity to reassert a media has a political nature and a purpose beyond the bare fact of it just existing. A lot of this rests on community media presenting a multi-level value proposition, with local just being one part of it. With the local element being a necessary but not a sufficient element. So that multi-level value proposition is made up of several items. Genuine engagement, a social business model, quality, relevant, diverse and accessible journalism, interesting and trustworthy. Genuine engagement. As a cooperative and as a community media organisation, we run lots of different free workshops on practical skills and also conceptual discussions about the sector, events from election hustings, film screenings, talks and so on, and also crucially involve our 540 paying members in decision making on wider principles and strategic questions. A social business model, one where the financial revenue streams that support the Bristol Cable and any other sort of community media is done in a way which is not at odds with its community aims. Crucially, as I say, that rests on our model of a membership basis, which means that anybody can join the cooperative from the littlest £1 a month. Currently stands, we have about 540 members who pay on average £2.50 a month. And we also have a regulated advertising revenue through an ethical advertising charter, which has been decided upon by the membership as a key example of how the members dictate the strategy of the cable. We also engage with third sector groups for trainings and for shared resources, schools, youth groups, other third parties as well. And we also do a lot of what was mentioned some in the presentation earlier, is mutual exchange advertising, so non-cash exchange advertising, and kind of working on a barter basis. Crucially though, and this is something I think that a lot of community media struggles with, is to have quality journalism, relevant, diverse and accessible. That's quite a tall order to have within a small publication, usually startups. A lot of the time the work is going unpaid. But we try to kind of like push up the ante in terms of what is the media that is being output by being put out by media outlets, community media outlets. And one of those things is working with visuals, working with print, which is completely crucial to our approach and our business model in terms of getting it out to a wide range of people, photography, illustration, and you're also using open data and closed data to talk about things that are crucial to people's daily lives. And something which is really hitting home at the moment is the housing crisis, and here's an example of an investigation that we did into empty homes in the Bristol area. The final thing is that with local, this applies to local media as well, and particularly to community local media, is that a lot of it's just boring. When we said that we were setting up a local media outlet, people were like, that's not boring. Where's the war and the, you know, the Westminster politics and the intrigue and the scandal? What we're trying to do is find a way to talk about national and international things on a local level. And part of that is to ensure that there's a relevance for the reader and a relevance for the community that's being engaged, that is on the level of their home and of their pocket and of their family, but also on the local, regional, national, even international level. Part of this is obviously crucially to be trustworthy. Now, trustworthy doesn't necessarily mean agreeable. So some of the information and editorial that we put out is not trying to live up to the old lie of objectivity in media, but one that kind of is transparent about the political beliefs of or political orientations of the journalists and of the editorial, and one that is supported crucially by facts and the clear demarcation between opinion, analysis and fact. But can it be all of these things and still be community? Depends on what obviously we mean communities are and what communities there are in question. And there is a risk, and there may be a risk that community actually comes to mean, actually only means a narrowly defined interest group. And that's always a kind of a consideration and a tension that needs to be dealt with organisations that are really trying to make a broadly based organisation, which is what we at the Bristol Cable are, and which we believe is crucial to the success and also the objectives of community media. Now that's the challenge, not without difficulties. But the power of this multi-level social value proposition of genuine engagement, quality journalism, a social business model is works perfectly within the media sector. Because most importantly, because it can be displayed within the publication itself, which initially unlike any sort of campaign or commercial activity, all it demands of the reader, of the consumer, however you want to describe them, is they pick up a print edition or they log into a website. And when you have that, a print edition or a website, it's in a space where they can just take it and be kind of passive, but also be engaging in a very clear way. In this way, it makes it easier for the cross-pollination of ideas, the sharing of knowledge and experiences, and the inter-community awareness and political engagement, hopefully. And as I say, this is especially the case in the print publication, where we ensure that we get out to a range of different communities and actively put it in their hands so it doesn't become a sectional community, but actually a broad-based engagement. Importantly, this all happens online and in print. So this is a space that is at once intimate and open, but also removed, perhaps comfortably so for some voices or ideas that may be expressed. A space where, unlike public meetings, someone's thoughts and opinions can be marshalled and presented free from the nerves and pressure of a conversation or public speaking. Social media also serves that function. So as examples of a variety that can come together in one media platform to share that knowledge and experience and information, powerful voices such as a woman speaking out about being a victim of revenge porn next to an infographic about the number of bailiffs that have been visiting the area. Lesser known political histories of the area, such as Bristol's Victorian coffee houses, which were a hotbed for radical discussion, next to a photo essay of that neighbourhood in the contemporary. Crucially, as I mentioned before, it's important to connect and make a thread of relevance between national and international issues down to the local, personal, neighbourhood, hyperlocal, however you like to see it. Of course, we live in an era of globalisation where more and more people yearn for a local grounding. All of this is produced and established by people in the community, of the community, and most importantly, owned by the community. So a potential future for the community media is to rediscover or recreate the politics behind it to produce quality information and ideas with a purpose, a broad purpose, not a tightly defined agenda, but an agenda nonetheless, carried by this multi-aspect value proposition displayed in the production and the consumption of media. In the context of established media financially struggling and startups like ours struggling even more, it's important to emphasise that this social value proposition needs to be a crucial and integral part of the overall business model, i.e. not just a social objective, but one that actively supports the financial viability of the organisation rather than hinders it. So, for example, advertising actively hinders proper investigative journalism in some cases. And in this way, we can actually recover and establish the brand loyalties and fostering genuine engagement and interest on whatever level that might be. The question for community media, then, is to how to best convert that theory into a viable financial model, because there's only so long that you can work for free. And that's it from me, and I invite you to take a couple of copies of back issues of the print edition, and they are for free. Thank you.
Really interesting for me listening to Adam, because in some ways my company is the absolute polar opposite to Bristol. Okay, we've been going for a very long time, back one of our newspapers, almost 300 years. But that said, some of the things that Adam talked about also resonate with us as well, notably trust and the importance of the brand and having that relationship with your readers. For a commercial organisation like mine, the biggest challenge in 2016 remains the same as it has done for quite a long time, which is, what does any business do when your customers decide they like your product, they're going to consume it more than ever, but they don't want to pay for it anymore? For those of you who don't know anything about the KM Group, I'll say a bit about our company's history. We're an independent, family-owned publisher based in Kent, and we have some of the country's oldest regional titles in our portfolio. One of them, the Kentish Gazette, was published right here in Canterbury in 1717. In fact, the monks of the cathedral made up its biggest daily readership to educated people. Over the decades, a lot's changed. We've launched titles, closed titles, bought titles. What's remained constant is that our business is founded on the premise that people are going to pay for our journalism. That started to change in the late 1990s when we bought the radio licenses that now make up the KMFM network. But the big game changer for us came in 1998 when we launched Kent Online. That was our first step into digital publishing that began a period of massive change and disruption for us. The 18 years between then and now make up a tiny fraction of our company's history, but it's been a time of unprecedented digital disruption. Today, Kent Online is the fastest growing regional news network in the UK, with more than 2 million unique monthly browsers. That represents the kind of penetration we can only have dreamed of when our newspaper circulations were at their peak. But, like so many others, the challenge for us is turning that audience into a profitable business that can stand on its own 2 feet without the safety net of its print portfolio. And whilst our audience is bigger than ever, so too is the number of competitors we now face. Who can imagine the world now without Rightmove, Monster, or countless others who have destroyed the traditional newspaper revenue streams? And who can imagine a world without Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or a world where the only source of truly hyper-local news is your weekly newspaper? So what then is the future for a business like ours? We remain family-owned, we're proud to be independent, and we're content to operate only within Kent. That makes us much different to some of the other big publishers who have used economies of scale to centralise functions and share generic content across vast regions to reduce their cost base. Instead, I believe the key to our future success lies in diversification and partnerships whilst building upon our traditional strengths. The most important of those strengths is a word that Adam used earlier, which is trust, the trust that people retain in our brand. As the media landscape gets increasingly cluttered, people rely on our journalists more than ever to report in an honest, trustworthy fashion. When scare stories spread unchecked across social media, it's up to us to put the story straight. When police and councils publish their own press releases on Twitter and Facebook, masquerading as news, it's down to us to cut through the spin. It's not easy, doesn't always make us popular. Again, something Adam alluded to, we are funded by advertisers, and it becomes increasingly difficult in this day and age to ensure commercial considerations do not impact on your editorial judgments. I'm thankful my company, being the company it is, has never lent on me in any way to pull stories. I'm sure it may happen elsewhere. We don't always get it right, but it's also important for us that we're regulated. We are IPSO members. When we get things wrong, we correct them quickly, and we're visible. We're visible in our patch, and we're accountable. And that trust is also valuable to our advertisers. In recent months, there's been lots of talk about something called the flight to quality, where advertisers have started questioning some of the stats that are put out by Facebook and Google. They want to know how many of their adverts really are getting read by real people rather than bots, how many of their videos are getting watched all the way through rather than just appearing in your Facebook timeline. And away from the headline figures, that audience engagement is becoming a much more important measure than just the page impressions alone. We know our audience, they know us, and this relationship will play a crucial role in our digital future. Trust on its own, though, of course, won't pay the bills. We employ 300 people, they rely on the KM to make their living. And any publishers who rely solely on selling display advertising on their websites for their future will have a tough time of it. I don't see any evidence, I'm sorry to say, that people are willing to pay for regional news online. That ship, I'm afraid, for most of us has long sailed. So instead, we're developing new revenue streams to bolster our online revenues and allow us to continue to invest in our journalism. We're harnessing all the skills you traditionally find in the newsroom and using those to build a new arm to our business. For example, last year we launched something called KM Create, which is our in-house marketing agency. If your company needs to develop a social media strategy, we can do that, or an advertising campaign, or build a website, we can do that for you. Of course, like lots of other people, but other companies in Kent do not have the standing and the history of the county that the KM has, and that's starting to generate a real level of revenue for us. Partnerships are very important for our future as well. At a local level, we're now working with the University of Kent. On our burgeoning video output. We've got a jointly funded newsroom on the university campus in Medway, where we produce the daily video bulletins that have already generated 2 million views since launching last year. From our point of view, we get access to the uni's experts and their state-of-the-art equipment. And when I say state-of-the-art, it is far above and beyond what you find in real newsrooms. And the university has the benefits for working newsroom on its campus, and hopefully we're going to start to share the revenue as well once local advertisers get comfortable with video as a medium. Partnerships are likely too with the BBC, although we're still defining what shape they may take. Could the BBC commission local media to supply court and council content in the same way it commissions independent programmers? We think so, although there are many hurdles to overcome as we search for a naturally mutually beneficial arrangement. Partnerships with third-party platforms will also play a big role in our future. Whether it's Facebook articles, Google accelerated pages, or Twitter moments, our journalists and commercial teams will have to become comfortable with their stories and adverts appearing across many different platforms, not just our websites. The article, rather than the platform, will be the currency, and Kent Online will be just one of many places we distribute it. As with the BBC, those business models are still being worked on. We need to make sure what works for Google and Facebook also works for the KM, because our news is our most valuable commodity. We hope we're on the right path as we continue to evolve our business, but in truth, none of us have really got the answers. Last week, Mima Lab released its predictions for journalism in 2016. There were 100 different experts giving their opinion, and 100 very different opinions. Some see the future as further consolidation, with the big fish swallowing the smaller fish, until there's only two or three traditional publishers left. Others take the opposite view and envisage a future with hyper-local models like the auction of news or co-ops like Bristol Cable. Some think that 2016 will be the year that print circulation decline becomes terminal. Others, including names respected as Sir Martin Saul, think 2016 is the year that print makes a comeback, as advertisers realise that the response rates in print far eclipse those online. The one thing I know for sure is that nobody really knows for sure which of these emerging businesses will be the answer. Finally, I should finish by saying that despite me waffling on about digital, we still see print as a hugely important part of the KM portfolio. Yep, circulations are in decline, newspapers cost a lot to produce and distribute, and they're not as sexy as a Vice or BuzzFeed, but there remains a huge loyal audience for our newspapers. More than 100,000 people still spend up to £1.20 a week on one of our products, and they spend up to 40 minutes reading it, and that's the kind of paid-for content and dwell time that any website would kill for. Thank you.
I'm a former practitioner, an activist, and an academic researcher, and I don't have time to talk about my current research, but I've left stuff out on the stand there. Transnational Radio Encounters. Dan, you can get a close-up of the website, the URL. I'm doing that with Caroline Mitchell in the University of Sunderland. It's called Transnational Radio Encounters. But it helps to know where a person's coming from. And that also applies to academic fields of study and research, to social movements, and, as those of us on the left are being reminded, to political parties, a reconnection with roots. Well, 20 years ago, my daughter, then six, came back from primary school where she'd been studying history and said, "Dad, you're an old artifact." Well, 20 years later, this old artifact feels that in order to talk about the future directions of community radio, it helps to remind ourselves of the anger and the pride that was the founding motivation 40 years ago of the community media movement in this country. There was anger at the close down of local cable experiments by cable companies who'd expected a Tory government to reward their efforts in local programming by allowing them to develop pay TV. Instead, Labour won the two elections of 1974. The cable companies were in a cul-de-sac. They pulled out at a day's notice in Sheffield, a week's notice in Bristol. I had to tell 100 or more volunteers that Rediffusion was closing down Bristol Channel, which had, with their help, produced 700 hours of programming over 2 years. The pride was in the astonishing strength and creativity of the voices heard across Bristol and in Sheffield and in Swindon, and as a result, ComCom was formed, the Community Communications Group. It published comments on the Annan Report, it gave evidence to a parliamentary select committee, it faded away and was a producer, followed by the Community Radio Association, which is now the Community Media Association. Anyway, I've written about that history in Janie Gordon's book on 21st century community media, and also in the Chris Appens Routledge Companion to Alternative Community Media, so I don't go into detail about that. Just say that despite examples of political inspired piracy in the early 80s, British community radio sector has never had the explosive origins that we saw in the European mainland. Here, it's been persistent lobbying with a careful adaptation to the policies of the government of the day that has succeeded. So in the Thatcher period, a small business philosophy pervaded community radio projects and short-term licenses that were available. And when finally in 2004 the community radio sector was authorised and launched, it took its place within the voluntary charitable sector, although it's administered by the DCMS, a sector that under this government is at the sharp end of a combination of outsourcing policy and cuts in local government spending which derive from this central government's misguided austerity policy. So where does British community radio stand today? Pump priming funding at the beginning for the first 15 stations came from £500,000 community radio fund supplied by the DCMS and administered by Ofcom. It's all this time later that £500,000 has not been increased to meet the needs of 230 stations or more. That's despite the recommendation by the person, Anthony Everett, who in 2003 evaluated the early pilots and said that at that time, 2003-04, something like £8 million would be necessary to support the sector. That's not to give all the money to the sector, it's to get them going, help pay, say, for one permanent staff person, and then it should be the volunteer effort of the community and so on. So the trouble here, in my view, is that in a much quoted slogan, community radio is 90% community, 10% media. As Zain Ibrahim said, push radio. What does that 90% cover? Let's start with training in communication, digital and internet skills, program research, production, presenting. Above all, the self-confidence that comes from the acquisition of those skills. I think of school students interviewing the local mayor and then their mate seeing them afterwards or hearing them afterwards, and word gets around, you too can do this. And who's receiving that training? Well, it is school and college students certainly, but often people outside the system, young and old, new to the community, migrants and refugees, or marginalized groups, women, again, minority ethnic communities. Aside from learning how to communicate in this field, community radio stations collaborate with local organizations and individuals to broadcast programs on public health, information about local services and amenities, about sport, the arts, encourage local music talent. It's often a nursery slope for a band that's going through to make money. If you just think of the range of government, central government departments that, who are benefited by the work done in that kind of way at the local level. And I'm talking about radio here, but of course there are video and other projects, indeed like Bristol Cable. None of those government departments contribute to the Community Radio Fund, because there's this box, thinking in boxes in Whitehall. It's media, so it's DCMS. The CMA managed to extract from the last Labour government a promise to approach other departments besides the DCMS to ask for contributions to the Community Radio Fund. Nothing happened, and then we had the Coalition and Osborne's economics. Now, in my view, it's high time that more British academics began to be active in the study and support of community media. MeCCSA's policy network has been rightly concerned with the post-Leveson press landscape and the campaign to save the BBC from right-wing stupidities. But how many MeCCSA members are tracking the situation where community radio is concerned? I'll ask that question directly, if I may, with a show of hands, Natalie. Yeah, but first, let's look at the community radio licensees based in universities and colleges. I count 11 with connections with higher or further education, including CSR here in Canterbury. Is anybody familiar with that? Oh, great. So perhaps you could give us some information. You're part of it in Christchurch. That's what C stands for,
yeah.
Is it?
No, Canterbury.
And then the well-established stations at the Universities of Bedfordshire, Lincoln and Sunderland, respectively, Radiolab, Sauron and Spark. And the 11th, to my surprise, I got this from Ofcom yesterday, Elaine Woodford, thanks to her. The 11 include three student unions who are licensees. In these places, students and staff are actually doing radio. Other staff make some members, or the PhD students. Whatever. So may I ask, who here is currently conducting or has plans for research on community radio? Let's leave it to radio. Okay, yeah, good. And who includes community media within the syllabus of a module or a course in our universities? Yeah, but not everyone.
Do, but
of course, I know that. Sorry?
Does it count if it's not British?
Right, yes, why not? We've got a lot to learn from across. There I see the other colleagues from Belgium. Okay, and who have you negotiated work, this is another question, but first an explanation, work experience in community radio stations? Or have you visited a community radio station? Have you asked community radio staff or volunteers to come along and talk to your students? So my question is, who has those kinds of relations with the community radio station? Okay, so this is looking up, really. Of course, support from the academic community is not in itself going to solve all the problems, and the problem above all of finance. Community Media Association also is in part, or has been, funded from that community radio fund. One person in Sheffield now runs the Community Media Association. A study by Steve Buckton and others, beginning in 2002, something like that, showed that all the successful similar associations in the Netherlands, in France, and so on, were supported, got some government support to run a representative association. So I'll just end with two possible, I should add, of course, that it's not community radio is going to change things, or community media, and we need the kind of collective, individual, and party political action that were being discussed this morning. But I'll end with two possible futures for British community radio, which are, for me, both deeply troubling. One comes from Spain, where before the recent election, while the right-wing government was still in power and expecting to win, the journal El Diario published a leaked document from the ministry responsible for media, eliminate this audiovisual category. And there's a need to rebuff extreme left-wing parties. Justification, lack of frequencies and availability of internet and digital media. Just like that, they lost the election. And they're still trying to form this left coalition. Of course, digital and internet, I'm not arguing that only community radio, Ofcom licensed and over the terrestrial airwaves is the only thing. Digital media and social media are important components of this project. But a right-wing government doesn't need to be repressive in that way. The free market does a very good job of censorship, as I think it was James Curran remarked a long time ago in regard to the British press. Well, the other example is from nearer home, unfortunately. It's a press release that came to us who subscribed to the CMA lists only yesterday. It announces the launch next month, of the radio hub in just this very region in southeast England, which, quote, will provide opportunities for networking and sharing best practice, as well as representing the interests of community radio with key organisations. The managing director of Radio Response, which is closely connected, David Harbour, says, there's nothing in any legislation that says community radio stations can't acquire a majority audience or procure a healthy income. We look forward to making certain third-tier radio stations not only survive, but also a viable marketplace success. Well, go to the Radio Response website and you get greeted by, want to make your station more money? Start here. We're a team of commercially driven, passionate radio people who are stealing revenues and market share for our community radio clients. Okay, so why should we be surprised by this? As the state is shrunken down and there's the outsourcing and other people are expected to supply the services, money is short, only one person runs the CMA. Of course, this is very attractive. But the language of the market that has already invaded the BBC, the NHS, higher education, the whole school system, here it is. And it's endorsed by the CMA itself in an email yesterday. So there's work to be done, I think, by MeCCSA members. And I just want to end, 1 minute over time here. Tomorrow, in the meetings we have at lunchtime of various networks, the Radio Studies Network will be having its meeting. But I would suggest, I think there's a social movement network, but there isn't anything that brings together all the different media that we might describe as community media. I've been a member of the IMCR for a long time, and there that started 1982, I think, local radio and television section, which has turned into the community communications section now, very flourishing. So maybe if you can spare time from your other meetings, come to the Radio Studies Network and let's give time to talk about whether we should present the executive with this kind of suggestion, since this is the theme of this conference. Okay, that's it.
Thanks for having me. I'm Andy Williams from Cardiff University's Journalism School, where I also work with our Centre for Community Journalism, which is mainly focused on a newer wave of online, predominantly online community news, the hyperlocal sector. Along with my collaborators, I've been doing some work on an AHRC-funded research project about hyperlocal community news. At least in part, my personal motivation is because I think that the crisis in in the local newspaper market, the established local newspaper market, is now so serious that we really, really need to take new entrants into this sector very seriously indeed. I'll talk to some findings of the research that we've done. We did a big snapshot content analysis of around 2,000 posts over 300 sites in a 10-day period, looking at topics, sourcing links, a whole bunch of other stuff. We did an online survey of around 180 UK community journalists, asking mainly about their content, their working practices, their revenues and business models, and a series of longer semi-structured interviews with 35 community news producers to add nuance and qualitative depth to the quant stuff that we did. The interviews and content analysis were done by myself and by Dave Hart and Jerome Turner from BCU. The survey was a collaboration between us and Steve Barnett and Judith Townend at Westminster, who were working on another AHRC-funded project, and we pooled resources. I thought hard what I could say in 10 minutes, and I've decided to take a selective look at the who, what, when, where, why, and how of UK hyperlocal news, with a view to stimulating some debate about its future. The sector is... Oh no, where is it gone?
So it didn't matter. You were talking so well.
It will. There it is, as if by magic. Thank you. What do we find? A who, first of all, then. Who produces this kind of community news? How do they describe what they do? Our survey results suggest that this is quite a well-established sector now, in internet terms at least. It's dominated by players who've achieved a degree of longevity. Nearly three quarters have been doing what they do for over 3 years, around a third for more than 5 years. 7 out of 10 producers see what they do as a form of active community participation. Over half as local journalism, straight up, and over half as an expression of active citizenship. Of course, there's overlap between these categories. Almost half also have some kind of mainstream journalistic training or experience. So this is not a sector dominated by or solely populated by citizen journalists. That's a popular misconception. So what gets covered in community news? What gets covered and who gets covered? We found that the largest category of news in our content analysis sample related to local community activities. These are posts about community groups, local clubs and societies, everyday life in the communities where these outlets exist. We also have a lot of stories about local councils, local government, so a lot of information which is at least potentially high in civic value. We also looked at news sources and who gets quoted. Like the commercial local news, official sources in local government, in business, in police are very important here. But a difference is the role afforded to members of the public and to people from local community groups, ordinary people. When you look at and when you compare with some of the studies of mainstream traditional newspapers, get more of a voice on the whole in this sector. So communities and local people are quite well represented by hyperlocal news. So there's a lot of information dissemination, which is linked to what I would call public interest news. There's a lot of voice and representation going on. Some of the traditional values we associate with news at whatever level are being played by these guys. More traditional social roles for news. Campaigns are of course important to local news's ability to advocate for communities, and investigations are important to the watchdog role, to the accountability role. 42% of our survey respondents said that they had started a campaign where their site has sought to change things locally in the last 2 years. Far more have joined in or supported or publicised the campaigns of others. And on investigations, a smaller group, but still quite sizable when you think that many of these people have no journalistic training or experience, have carried out an investigation which has helped uncover new information about local civic issues and events in the last 2 years, which I think is quite impressive. How is hyperlocal funded? Around a third of our survey participants make money, mostly very modest amounts. 13% say they generate more than £500 a month. We didn't ask a bigger category than that, so we don't know how many generate more. Most community news producers fund the running costs for their own sites from their own pockets, suggesting high levels of volunteerism, with only around 1 in 4 raising enough money to at least cover their costs, and 16% more than cover their costs. So again, not huge amounts of money being made in the sector. While lots of people employ a mixture of revenue streams, online advertising is the dominant form of income generation among those who seek to make money. Not all of them do, in fact most of them don't seek to make money. But a number of other methods are employed, like audience and worker cooperatives. Audience cooperatives can be a revenue stream. Getting grant money from charities and foundations. Fund more stable charity funding through local development trusts. Getting money from cross-subsidizing their local news work with other streams of income. So there's cross-subsidy at an individual level going on here with things like training or consultancy or copy editing work. And increasingly you see print advertising models using free newspapers being employed by a growing number of these local news practitioners. Problem with the advertising is that many suffer from lack of visibility in their communities and penetration too. So those that do seek to monetize their sites with advertising often have an uphill struggle. And overall, I think that this suggests that while the market may sustain some community news operations under some conditions, it's currently unable to sustain this kind of news on a large scale, in a plural way within communities, and consistently across the country. Another how. How sustainable is hyperlocal news? In our interviews, we couldn't help being struck by the indications of the precarious nature of many community hyperlocal news operations. People's professional and personal circumstances change. People get burned out. This is something that Dave's research that he's leading on and that we're collaborating on has been drawing out well in some of our more recent publications. So the quality, the consistency, and the longevity of hyperlocal news sites, it varies because of this. There's also a point here to be made about the largely non-institutional nature of hyperlocal news. Because these services are so closely tied to the personal circumstances of individuals, there is no guarantee that a news outlet will survive the loss of key contributors, key editorial staff. Widespread voluntarism in this sector is producing bags of public value, I think, but it's a fragile foundation, and it may not be enough to sustain community news sites in the long term. Without the profits needed to remunerate people, the sector may well be too precarious to sustain the kind of institutions which have previously been necessary prerequisites for a strong, independent, and critical local news. When and where? The regularity and volume of publication and the geographic consistency of coverage across the UK is patchy, it's variable. The numbers of hyperlocal news producers, as well as their labour power, should also be put into some kind of perspective. So to do this in a rough and ready way, I compared the numbers of new hyperlocal news producers with the numbers of redundant professional journalists in my area to give a rough indication of what's been lost and what's been gained there. Media Wales, which serves Cardiff and the surrounding valleys in South Wales, employed almost 700 editorial and production staff in 1999. There were just 111 left last year. How many community journalists have taken their place? Well, the local web list map of community news sites, which is a great resource, they list 20 sites in Media Wales's patch, and they're run by around 40 regular news contributors, most of them working part-time for little or no money. So in terms of the numbers of news producers and their capacity for mainly part-time work, hyperlocal can only very partially plug the growing local news deficits, which are caused by the withdrawal the significant withdrawal of journalism from local newspapers. Just to conclude with a why, and maybe a controversial why, maybe not. Looking at these data, you see three broad groups of hyperlocal news producers. Firstly, there's a small group of themselves, small, often precarious, but crucially economically viable community news services. This is a rare good news story about local news. Secondly, a number of sites are run by hobbyists and they're now trying to professionalize in different ways. And thirdly, we've got a much larger, also precarious group of volunteer-led efforts who have no interest in making money, who'll carry on doing this as long as they want to, or until they burn out, or until they decide to do something else. Now, players in all three groups are producing public interest news of varying quality and quantity, and lots of news which isn't in the public interest as well, of course. But they face some serious challenges in a tough market which is dominated by established publishers who are in control of dwindling local or regional advertising monopolies in many cases. And I think that local news here, and this kind of local news, should be seen as a public good.
And for me, one of the last things that Andy ended with, the loss and gain with the loss of lots of local newspapers, and how much replacement or gain do we get in the community news sector in particular, is a really key issue. Some recent work that we did under the auspices of the Media Reform Coalition showed that 5 companies own 80% of local newspaper titles and account for 85% of local newspaper revenue. But maybe more interesting than that kind of, you know, real dominance and lack of plurality in the market is that of the 406 local government authorities in the UK, only 131 are served by a local newspaper. So that's a non-community local newspaper. So that leaves 275 local government authorities without any local newspaper. So one of my questions would be, because as far as I'm aware, we don't have the data that maps one against the other.
We will soon. Yeah, Martin Moore and Gordon Ramsay.
Tonight?
Well, next week,
maybe.
Next week?
Yeah.
This month, at least, though.
Oh, that was my question, is can we get that? And can we see those gaps, whereas you're hinting the experience in Cardiff is being, whereas this is rich and diverse and wonderful in many ways, it's no way a replacement for, a regular daily news service that we can rely on to do the sorts of work that needs to be done, to hold power to account in local communities. But tell us what we will have next week.
I reviewed it kind of, I probably shouldn't have said anything. I reviewed it kind of, confidentially, so I'm not sure if I'm
Breaking news!
Well, it's similar research to what you've done, and it really, it does further research on concentration of ownership, and lack of plurality. They come up with some slightly different figures than the campaign's report. They found that 4 publishers now own 73% of UK titles post the Trinity Mirror merger, of course, with 58 owning the rest, which is extreme concentration of ownership, isn't it? When you think that the Royal Commission on the Press was set up because 4 companies own 33% of the local news titles. This is extreme, and they've also gone on to show that the majority of local authority districts have no dedicated local newspaper coverage. Most of the weekly newspapers which are left are shells of their former selves, and they've mapped that against the existing what we know about existing kind of hyperlocal and community organisations, local television. So you can see that there are huge, it's a map-based report actually, you can see that there are just huge gaps, there are just huge news black holes in the way that we've assumed there have been for a number of years now, but soon we'll have the data to just be able to pinpoint on a map in that way. And it also, of course, it doesn't take into account the point that I was making, and more work is needed on that front, I think, just to quantify what's replacing the withdrawal of journalism from these areas. And when I say the withdrawal of journalism, I don't just mean the closure of newspapers, but I mean the closure of local offices, the binning of local editions, and the huge numbers of journalists that we've lost from these newsrooms. You know, that's in Cardiff, that's 80% of the workforce gone in 15 years. It's going to have a serious knock-on effect, isn't it? And when you think of, I mean, I'm a huge advocate for much of the hyperlocal news that I've been studying and researching for the past few years. We have to look at this in relative terms, don't we? And we can't put that kind of pressure on the hyperlocal sector. They can't be a replacement. They're only ever going to be a small part of a local news plurality ecology, I guess, you know, and a very small part of that, a valuable one for many, but not replacing what we need.
No. You know? One of the things that is frequently said to the media reform groups when we go and talk to people in parliaments about this is, but surely these groups can work together more. Why don't things like Bristol Cable work more with things like KM Group? Can't you share resources? But I was really struck, Adam, in your talk, how the ethos is so completely different that would change the nature of your product, of what you do, to such an extent that might actually then lead to the demise of what you do in a certain way.
I think it obviously depends on the relationship, but I think in a way, yeah, like we trade off in a large respect the disgust and distrust with the mainstream media. And that's not saying we wouldn't work with KM Group or any other reputable organisation, but I definitely think that's would be a case, and that's the niche that we're trying to exploit. The other thing, one of the big differences about what the Bristol Cable does is that right now we're talking about news, daily news, weekly news. We don't really do news. We do features, we do investigations, we do voices, and these things, one of our taglines is the stories behind the daily news. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we achieve, two things with that. One is kind of a strategic and practical objective, and the other is like a political or social one. The strategic one is that we don't have to be chasing around every single day to collect news to publish daily online or in print, which will never be able to beat even the kind of the rump of the existing traditional outlets in the city or anywhere. And two, that's where we see is where the more valuable source of information and ideas is. Like, one of the things that is totally missing from local news is context, is analysis, is depth, is breadth. Yeah. And that's why we're a magazine, really, and not a newspaper.
Yeah. Yeah. But Ian, could you see, I mean, you have this interesting relationship with Kent University now, which is, I think, something that is starting to happen in a few places with a few papers. One of the concerns I have there is that there you've got students, or you've got a public-funded sector essentially supporting a commercial outfit, which, you know, can introduce interesting antagonisms in it. In the same way that when you're talking about working with the BBC and, you know, maybe the BBC offering content to local newspapers, the debate there is that actually, but that's public-funded. You know, why should a public-funded institution then support commercial profit-making enterprises? So, you know, that's the...
That's an argument, but then the BBC does support independent funding.
Yeah, no,
where
indeed.
It's different. University, yes. I mean, it's actually a separate company that got the university called KMT Limited. Okay. So there's not any exchange, there's not the university backing the KM or vice versa. Mm.
Could you see working with the likes of Bristol Cable?
Well, not based in Bristol, yes, possibly.
Yes,
I mean, if there was a then possibly something. I mean, I passionately support anything that invests in journalism, in text journalism, because it's something I care about deeply. I think when we talk about job losses, we need to put some context around it and say, look, the world has moved on, things are modernised, a lot of job losses have come in the field of newspaper production. You don't need quite so many subs sitting there manually dragging things onto pages. Much I hate to say it, you can't dispute the fact that smartphone technology means you can get pictures a lot easier than you could in the past. You don't need to send a snapper out to every single job you go on. So it's not a case of reporters necessarily bear the brunt of the job cuts. I think most companies are trying to take the approach, they'll protect the people who go out and actually gather the stories.
Although we do know in Trinity Mirror that a lot of journalists' jobs...
Well, I wouldn't dispute that some journalists' jobs have actually gone, but I think any publisher with a brain to recognise the important things for your company, the people that govern the stories, and people who sell the adverts. And if everything that surrounds them is where you'd be looking if you need to reduce your cost base.
Can I just chip in, not directly, but yeah. Just to say that there have been collaborations between hyperlocals and local news groups, really fruitful ones as well, so it's not something that just doesn't happen.
Yes.
There's lots of it. But
it's how that can be taken forward, I guess. I could talk about this forever, but I'm not going to. So, Jonathan, and we collection?
I'd like to ask a question to Ian Carter, particularly as I gave an earlier session on native advertising, which you mentioned. You gave a very eloquent defence of the protection of editorial integrity in the first part of your speech, but then included native is part of the welcome new streams in the latter part. I really want to invite you to comment on a view which says native advertising is parasitic, a destructive parasite. It feeds on the trust that you outlined in the first part, but ultimately will undermine it.
Native advertising. First of all, to my view, it's no different to an advertorial in a newspaper, and they've existed since the year dot. You would get some copy about Fish and Chip Week, write some journal copy, sell some adverts around it. I don't really see native advertising as any different to that, as long as all the way through you're making it very clear if a piece of content is sponsored or paid for. If we were taking the view we were going to start running stories on our website that had a commercial input and we didn't identify it as being so, completely agree with you. I don't see an awful lot wrong with us trying to create advertorials online. Not least because it's one of the very few ways you can avoid the ad blockers. And I think you get to the point that people don't want to pay for online content, and nor are they prepared to look at the adverts themselves either. Then where does that leave us?
Do you want to go first, Anita?
It doesn't matter.
I worry about contamination. You were suggesting that, you know, why can't they all work better together? Why can't? Well, I don't think that because of the different models, you know, one is a profit-driven model, however small that profit might be in comparison to the likes of Murdoch, and a cooperative with a, you know, a social model. I cannot see somehow how these things can be reconciled, and the contamination could, you know, harm this particular model.
Well, that's interesting. Let's get a response there. Cause
just as a point of information, really, you know, Adam represents, I'd say, the more political and ideologically engaged end of the kind of hyperlocal news sector. I don't know if he even identifies as a hyperlocal news producer. But there's a huge spectrum here, and I'd say that most of the people that I've been talking about wouldn't share those kinds of political ideological concerns.
I mean, I think it depends on the terms of in terms of engagement, and then what is put forward, like, transparently to the readers. And also, like, to clarify, we aren't scared of money. We're not, like, out there for profit, but we realise, both as a practical and again as a political objective, and this is what I tried to put across in my presentation, that we need to be able to marry the social and the kind of practical financial objectives. Access it, there needs to be money involved so people can be rewarded for the work that they put in. Like, for people who are struggling to on low-paid jobs and so on, we want them to contribute to the cable, and we don't want them to lose time or money over it, and we want to reward that and quantify it as well in a way that is moves beyond just what they produce. And I think that's really important to kind of give various reasons, and also to kind of bring community media out of kind of being a byword for, like, not very good. Like, we are a community media outlet, but our journalism is, like, way better than the Bristol Post. So who is, like, why is it just a community outlet?
And, you know, the BBC gave £25 million to local TV, a largely failed experiment. How much better?
Yes, no, but that's what I'm saying. I mean, you know, you yourself said that, you know, it has coalesced around shared interests, and it's not about money, essentially.
Money is a part of it, in order to keep it going. And that comes back to what Ian just said, like, we don't do and probably wouldn't do native advertising in that way, but, like, if you don't do it, then you don't have anything. And then we're not really having a conversation.
Yeah, I wanted to just pick up on the idea of making content interesting and ask about interesting for whom, and particularly in terms, I was thinking of demographics, and particularly the older and elderly members of communities, and whether their interests are actively considered when planning magazines and news and so on. I think his, from what I know from my friends and extended family, is purely anecdotal. Local news has been of particular value, maybe community news as well, community radio, I'm not sure, but it always has been. And I imagine that you must have a struggle in terms of making content interesting. What do you do? Do you try to address across the generations? Do you consider the demographic and how it's weighted?
That's to me, yeah.
Well, I'm also thinking.
Yeah, so I mean, it's broadly defined. You know, there's lots of different types of pieces. There's kind of like voice pieces, which is kind of like first person pieces. There's history pieces, which might appear to appeal to an older person. There's investigations, or a range of pieces of content. And I think one of the things that we're trying to contend with is that actually I'm not sure how much demographics is the kind of key indicator of what makes it interesting.
It might be relevant.
I think it's definitely relevant. But like, what maybe there's other indicators that are based around values or other things that kind of, or locations like within the city that are a mix of demographic indicators and personal experience that will make a piece of content interesting to them. And so we do try to have a range of content and make it broad and as a key principle of ours, but we also know that there's some people who aren't going to be interested in it, and that is kind of something we're quite comfortable with.
And do you have older and senior news producers or content producers?
Yeah. Like we have like, I mean, in the next print edition, we publish online as well, but the next print edition will be out in about 5 days, and there's like a first time 16-year-old, there's a university student, there's a professor, there's a 60-year-old. You know, there's all
ancient.
Sorts of. there's all sorts of people. There's somebody who's writing, who's a Somali, who's writing in English and in Somali. There's people who, and then there's all the people who do the research, and there's kind of the design and the illustration, who come from a range of different backgrounds as well. And quite crucially, like, we do a lot of practical trainings that we organise, either that we deliver ourselves or we bring somebody else in from the organisation, university, or some other sort of like training group, and actively go out and try to bring people in to get involved in participating and producing the magazine. But yeah, I mean, it is always a struggle to, and an important one to continue to make it broad. But at the same time, you have to kind of like draw lines that it doesn't just become wishy-washy and watery and like non-committal, which is kind of what a lot of local journalism is now.
From our point of view, yes, of course, we're trying to spread across the demographics. We've got very different patches. We've got East Kent Mercury circulating, Deal, very sleepy seaside town, or a place like Medway, opposite. More interesting for me, really, is how much we should concentrate on the website analytics to determine content on there, because we know for an investigation up, good piece of journalism, might get a few thousand hits. Stick my photo of a cat that looks like, get lucky, it'll go mad. And if we just try and work really hard for the way of just going for that kind of viral rubbish. That's where the spread gets really.
Yeah, that's true. Sometimes then, when you're just chasing the bottom line and you're just chasing clicks,
yeah,
then that's the difficulty we comes in. I've seen 1, 2, and 3.
Well, this panel's great, lots of interesting discussion in many areas. I was quite interested to discuss volunteerism, and I was really interested to hear you talk about it, because I was concerned that there were no policies in place to protect volunteers in these areas, in community radio, and as you're saying, in your local magazine, etc. What does the panel think about this? Because obviously you've got the situation where, as you mentioned, you know, 600 jobs have been lost in the sector. That's also happening in other areas, in museums, where museums are being closed and then reopened with volunteers running them. This means, you know, we're all working in education here, providing people to work in these kind of areas, and then you have a volunteer force who have no rights at all. What do you think? You know, should policy be made to sort of help those that are volunteering to have, you know, a stronger situation? Because I am concerned that you have many community stations just run by one or two people, and at their whim sometimes. And that's always a good thing.
Hi, my name is Johnny Greatrex. I'm a journalism lecturer here at Canterbury Christchurch, but I want to declare a small interest that until June I was a Trinity Mirror employee fully paid up in the Birmingham Mail's newsroom, so I've got a very sort of dual slight sort of take on this, and it's divergent from the last point. But there's two things I wanted to ask, one to Adam and one to Ian, obviously we'll come back to them. But Adam, I was really interested in what your kind of perceived end game is, where you want to get to, what would be in your terms success for Bristol Cable. Would it be commercial viability? Would it be to last for 5-10 years? Would it be to change the world? You know, what are you driving at? And to you, Ian, I was interested in, do you foresee the future of the KM group as continuing to do the same news that goes in the printed product online, or do you see the need to morph into a kind of new digital kind of entity with a different identity? Because my former employer, Trinity Mirror, is probably going more down that second route than the first one.
Okay, then let's take those two and then we'll come to the question at the back. So voluntarism, issues relating to voluntarism.
Well, there's currently going a discussion, a thread going on in the CMA lists, Max, have you noticed that?
Yeah.
About the job status of people who volunteer in community radio, and opinions are coming across the country, and when I last read it, one advice was make certain the local job centre knows what you're doing. Another is pay them but make certain you get the money back. It's sort of crude ways of getting around the fact that this is an experience that's very important, but some the rules now of gaining benefits and how you classify work are making it very difficult. I can't really add much more to it than that. I've got a question I want to ask Andy later.
I'll answer the volunteer question for me. The settings that you gave as examples, museums, community radio stations, I guess you'd add libraries to that these days, sadly. These are all institutional forms of volunteerism, aren't they? The hyperlocal sector is largely non-institutional. It's not like there is a hyperlocal website office. You know, it's in the bedroom of these people. When I talk about volunteerism, it's much more in the context of people just spending part of their day using digital technology, and in some cases getting a print product out and delivering it and all that kind of thing, just off their own bat. I'm not sure if it's possible to protect that form of volunteerism in the kind of governmental or state related way that you suggest. But what we can do, and that's what the Centre for Community Journalism at Cardiff tries to do, is to, you know, maintain conversations in the field, to foster and support and to provide training and information to people, much in the same way as Ian was talking about, the long history of that kind of you know, investing in the community, in community radio, and we give legal training and things like that, because there are risks associated with becoming publishers, aren't there? And you know, that's the kind of non-state, non-institutional support that we can give, I guess, and that we are giving at the Centre for Community Journalism. But I'm not sure if there's any other kind of appropriate protection or possible protection that could be offered, but maybe I'm missing the point.
Adam, perceived end game?
The perceived end game, I guess it's three related strands. One is to make the model work, to have a democratic membership and that mainly funds and supplemented by other sources of income, feature an investigative based local journalism magazine, and to have it mainly funded by members And so, for example, we've got almost 600 members now, with 2,500 members we'll be in a position where we'll be able to pay people, all people, something. Not like, you know, like good, really good rates, but something. And we're already covering all of our costs, like healthily. The next thing then would have to be to test this model, and to prove the model would be to replicate it. So watch out, Birmingham Mail. No, but like seriously, because this is something that can happen in a lot of different places, and if we can lay out a blueprint, then it can be fit, then it can be worked to match in different places in the UK or elsewhere. And that would be like an ideal. I don't know if that's going to happen. Things could change, and that is the last point. Part of it could change is that there is always a risk of burnout or it being too reliant on just a small handful of people, whilst now we're just going through like a period of expansion, so there's a lot of people, more people getting involved, compartmentalising what was initially just a startup. But so there's a risk in that period that we don't kind of like bridge the gap between being a startup and being an established organisation. But when we're an established organisation, a test of that will be when the founders, so myself and several others, will be able to leave and the pillars won't collapse. And that would be the ideal. So make the model work, replicate it, and be able to leave.
Just one thing to come back with. Sorry, before you go, just go back on one thing. Do you see kind of either crowdfunding of your model or crowdsourcing of your content to be any options that you would go down?
Well, I mean, we did a crowdfunder very early on, and raised a few thousand. But effectively, the membership model is crowdfunding continuously. See, one of the problems with the crowdfunding model is that you make a big noise and a fuss about you've got 15 days to get this much. We do that on a monthly recurring basis with direct debits, and that's what the membership model is. Yes. We know what we're getting, we know where it's coming from, and it hasn't been as quick as we wanted to because we haven't been in the position to deliver like a really good strategy to get more members, but that's what we're working on now, and then that will be crowdfunded. The crowdsourcing of journalism, we do that already in two ways. One is that we have a pitch form on the website where people can pitch their ideas. And then two, we have quite good and growing connections with various different groups and individuals in the city that when something comes up that we think might be interesting, we commission them or brief them and work with them to produce an article or a video, whatever it might be. Part of the problem with the crowdsourcing of media is ensuring the quality controls are in place. And that's something, like I've said before, we really want to up the game in terms of quality of community media. And not just kind of get activist groups or press releases or kind of like business advertising disguised as like articles. And part of that is like actually getting out and making sure we don't just get the social science graduates who want to talk about something and get, you know, the voices of different people in the community to go along with the social science graduates.
Absolutely. You did get some seed funding from the co-op system, didn't you?
We did,
originally.
Yeah.
And there is actually, if anybody's thinking of doing this or developing it with their students, Dave Boyle's written a brilliant booklet on how to be a media co-op, which is a really worthwhile seeking out. Ian? Digital entity?
No, I don't really see the agenda or the ethos changing. I mean, there's obvious things will change with the method delivery because we know that video is going to be increasingly important to get online. And we know that when you get 80% of your online audience coming from mobile, they don't really want long-form journalism or analysis. And that's where we've created more analysis, web, more shorter, snappier bites. But the ethos and the agenda, no, I don't really see it as a different thing. The current digital tipping point, no doubt, where Kent Online brings in more revenue than the newspapers. It's obviously two ways you can get there. Either your revenue newspaper goes like that, or it's the latter, but no, I don't see it.
I have one more question here, then I have a burning question I must ask.
It's more or less a remark of your the guys in the panel also, because from my understanding, it's more to do with the ethos and value of an organisation, not necessarily the structure. It could be a charity, it could be a private organisation, but with a very good mission statement or ethos, and the product will still be the same. So to a large extent, that might not be a problem with mergers and
cooperation between the different types of models we see from the panel.
Right, my burning question is this, right? I have a meeting with the Corbyn office, so this takes us back to Peter's original point and the opening plenary. I have a meeting with Corbyn's office on Monday under the auspices of the Media Reform Coalition. We know that Corbyn is very keen on local media. He sees it hasn't, he's held his cards very close to his chest, or it has none, around media policy right now, but has declared an interest in local media just before Christmas. What should I tell him?
Can I ask your question in a way to Andy? Because at your last slide, you talked of some public subsidy going into local media. Now, is there a chance that, as we learned this morning, as we know, things are breaking up all across the UK and it's different in Wales, does the amount of devolution available in Wales allow that to happen despite whatever Corbyn decides or the English Labour Party? No, it doesn't.
No, no.
You've got to play the rules of Westminster.
Media policy is still in
Of course it is, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
So, you know, well, obviously there's lots of lobbying that goes on all the time with present government, but here we have, an opposition party ready and willing to form new media policy. They're looking for new bit and keen on local media. What do we say?
I'd say, oh, Jeremy.
Hand over the cash.
And we'd be pushing it around, wouldn't we? But you'd have to say, we need a local media policy, for starters. We haven't had one for years. We've had national regulation, attention on the national media. And while that's been happening, there's been a kind of a creeping crisis in local news provision that's led to the kind of monopolies that I was talking about, that's led to real lack of plurality. And we need to do two things. We need to review existing subsidies for local media, because although many in the big four, big five publishers that you were talking about like to think that there is no public subsidy for local media, there's plenty, isn't there? You know, we've got statutory notices, we've got the VAT tax breaks for newspapers, all there to protect media plurality and public interest news at a local level. This needs to be opened up for new, smaller providers of online news, and where it doesn't apply, like the VAT on print, we need equivalent help for new, to encourage new local startups of the kind that Adam is representing, and many other different kinds as well. And I'd say that the second thing that we need is a new policies to stimulate local news plurality at a local level. And I really like Martin Moore's report on positive plurality and what can be done to do that. And one of the key ideas there is a competitive fund, which any kind of in my ideal situation, small local news organisations can bid for to get bridging money, which will help them experiment with new models of delivery and funding, experiment with different ways of doing local news, not all advertising based, some of them charity, cooperative. There are lots of different options which are out there and showing small success at a very local level in limited places at the moment. We need some seed funding for these guys to help them become more profitable, to experiment with different models of existing.
So a media trust fund funded by tax on Google.
Like a night local news. it's got to be tax on Google, tax on Facebook. They don't pay the taxes anyway. You know, it's got to be a progressive taxation because the public wouldn't wear paying for it themselves.
Look across the channel, see how the French are doing. They tax the commercial audiovisual sector to help funding their particular form of community radio. In the Netherlands, there is a local government receives money from the central government, which is intended to go to help support local media, and doesn't always, I gather. Are you from Belgium? Or?
I'm from Italy, the Italian government has just made Google hand over £318 million worth of unpaid tax. They are owed about €800 million. So, yes, this is what needs to be done here.
Yeah. And there's one example you won't like to hear about, Natalie, which is some of the license fee in Denmark, I think, goes towards local media. Of course,
I don't mind if it's not for profit.
What?
I don't mind if it's not for profit.
No, top slicing license fee.
Yeah. For not for profits, I have a less of an issue with.
Oh, really?
Yeah, there you go.
Yes, I've kept a bit quiet, and I've been in MeCCSA policy network meetings. But you know, I have to say that ComCom, all those years ago, suggested that, you know, a penny in the license fee ought to support community media generally. Yeah. So I would actually seriously ask one of his advisors to look again at the Everett report, which was 2003, and also I could track for you, if you like, the report of the acknowledgement by a Labour minister in the last days of whatever it was. What was that man's name? Brown. which undertook to ask other government, central government departments, yes, to contribute to the Community Radio Fund.
Yeah, no, very good. I will.
Okay.
Without the obvious, I'm trying to find something that isn't, yeah, like just give over some money, which is like the obvious one. But I think, and I haven't fully thought this through, but I think an interesting point would be to look at the relationship between local media and local government, and how, what the changing nature of local government, which has changed a lot over the past 5 years, and what that means for holding power to account on local level or information and these sorts of things. You know, so often, like now, we're asking councillors or the council press office or individuals within the kind of like council stratosphere within Bristol, and they're like central government. Like their hands are being tied by central government directives, and then like who are we to hold to account? And that's the gravitation of power to Westminster, despite the so-called localism agenda. So I would think it would have to be tied into a much broader kind of agenda for decentralisation of power, and you know, more accountable mechanisms at the local level.
Yeah, no, that's a really important issue.
I say, forget the local media, because I think I am very challenged by the idea that commercially any regional publisher can have a monopoly in the days of Facebook and Google. We pay our taxes. And I'm also saying the biggest scandal in journalism isn't anything to do with phone hacking, it's to do with the amount of money being spent by public authorities on ever increasing press offices and police forces, and the amount of ex-journalists who are now employed to spin the news at a huge cost to the public.
Which is why we need Leveson 2. That's the perfect part to end on, because that's exactly what that would investigate, which has been brushed under the carpet currently. So thank you, fantastic panel.
I'm standing before you today as a friend and ally fascinated with but not in media studies. And I'd written down all sorts of clever points about the conceptual overlap in terms of shared interests in voice and representation and democratic theory to demonstrate the dialogue, I think, that I've been continuously engaged in with colleagues in media studies. But I think really what says it all is our splendid victory in the pub quiz last night, if I may remind you.